vinyl community. Today I'm going to be jumping on a thread started by my good friend John over at JB's Vinyl and Cassette. He's got a great channel. If you haven't checked it out, please do. You will be thoroughly entertained. I love the style of his videos. I love the fact that he makes it look so easy being on camera and talking about music. And he knows so much about music, and he's got a great collection also. So please make sure you check John's channel out. But the thread that I'm jumping onto is pick five albums from the year you were born. Now, I was born in 1970, the year the Beatles broke up. I just missed them. But anyway, I have picked five albums from that year. There were quite a few great albums to choose from. First one I selected is Elton John's self-titled album. It's not his debut. His first album was actually Empty Sky the year before. But I think this is Elton John's first great album. You've got Your Song on here, Border Song, Take Me to the Pilot. So many great tracks on here. And it really showed what a great songwriter he was. You got Paul Buckmaster doing some very tasteful string arrangements. I Need You to Turn To is a great soft ballad track. I like this album a lot. Your Song was the first Elton John song I think I ever heard. But there's a lot of great stuff on here, and I really like it a lot. You've got the band here. You've got Paul Buckmaster, who did the string arrangements. Gus Dudgeon, who produced the album. Caleb Quay, who actually would rejoin Elton John's band on the Rock of the Westies album that he did. And Steve Brown. No idea who Steve Brown is, but being helpful if they would put exactly what instruments they played or what their role was, so you didn't have to guess. But anyway, great album. Second album, The Doors, Morrison Hotel. This was The Doors' return to form after the jazz pop that was a soft parade. This album opens up, of course, with Roadhouse Blues, and then Waiting for the Sun, which was a leftover track from the Waiting for the Sun album, You Make Me Real. Then you got Peace Frog, right into Blue Sunday, which is a nice gentle ballad. I love Land Ho. The Spy is a great, almost like cocktail jazz type track. Queen of the Highway is another great road song. And Maggie McGill is a great, great blues track. Would have fit very well on L.A. Woman, and it actually kind of points the way to the style that they would use. They would get into more blues territory on their next album, L.A. Woman. But this is fantastic. I love this album. Definitely one of my favorite Doors albums. The next album that I want to show is McCartney by McCartney, since we just got McCartney 3 last year. But this album, when it came out, I think it shocked a lot of people just because it was not what they were expecting. They were used to the Paul McCartney, who had composed such sweeping, majestic tracks like Hey Jude and The Long and Winding Road and Let It Be and the great medley from the Abbey Road album. And then what they got were a lot of tracks that sounded like half-finished demos. Paul kind of fooling around in the studios. Now, he did play all the instruments himself on this album. He got some harmonies from Linda McCartney. But really, Paul is just having fun. It's his first solo album. All the pressure from the Beatles years is kind of weighing on him because all the expectations are Paul McCartney's going to knock him dead. And it's not really what happened. People got this album and their expectations had to be lowered a bit. The most notable and the greatest track on this album is definitely Maybe I'm Amazed, but Every Night is fun. I think Ooh You, it's got a great, you know, rock riff to it. Some of the other stuff is definitely throwaways, like The Lovely Linda, That Would Be Something. Valentine's Day is a cool instrumental, but it's pretty insubstantial. Mama Miss America is not bad. It's just, it's fun. It's Paul McCartney in retrospect. I think not his best album, but I enjoy it a lot. It's sort of like the throwaway tracks that he did on the White Album, but I like it. I'm sorry. I listen to it a lot more than maybe some of his other solo albums. But anyway, definitely worth checking out if you are not already familiar with it. Next album I'm going to show is Adam Hart Mother by Pink Floyd. Love this album. I'm sure not too many people do, just because The whole first side is the track Adam Heart Mother, and it's subdivided into a number of different sections. And it's got some elements that have never appeared before or since on a Pink Floyd album. It's got a chorus, it's got some chanting, it's got orchestration, all these elements that you never heard before on a Pink Floyd song, but it's definitely interesting to hear Pink Floyd stretch out a little bit. I like it a lot. I think it is an interesting journey all the way through, and it keeps you interested. You never get bored with this album. The second side are all individual tracks. You got Summer 68, which was a Richard Wright composition. You've got If, which was Roger Waters, his contribution. You've got David Gilmour with kind of the pastoral Fat Old Son, which is an enjoyable track. And then the interesting sound collage of Alan's Psychedelic Breakfast, which again is interesting. I don't know, it's something that you'd want to listen to over and over again, but it's fun. I like this album, and I might be alone in that opinion, but I don't care. I think it's a cool album. I think it's something different that Pink Floyd had never tried before, and I like it. Last one I'm going to pick is Chicago 3, their least successful, both commercially and critically, of their first three double albums. Can you believe there's no other band, in at least that I'm aware of, that their first three albums were all double albums in the space of 3 years? And so definitely you can tell they were kind of running out of gas. They were running out of ideas. Not that this is a bad album, but you know, it's got Lowdown on here. It's got Free. I think, you know, Loneliness Is Just a Word. I enjoy that track. And there are some moments, you know, An Hour in the Shower, that whole kind of suite at the end of the second record is, you know, it's okay. But definitely it is not as strong as Chicago Transit Authority or the second Chicago album. But I don't care. It's Chicago. You know, I mean, what do you want? It's definitely, you know, Terry Kath still doing his Terry Kath thing. He's still, you know, this is still when they were more a rock band than they were trying to be a pop band, as they would sort of evolve into over the years. But yeah, I don't know. I think it's a cool, cool album. So those are my five. I do have one more album that actually, it's funny because my son James, he watches me do these videos all the time, and he's always saying he wants to make a video, and can he make a video? So I recorded him doing a video, and he actually kind of mishandles the record a little bit, but I don't know. He sees Dad do it, and he thinks it's cool. So if you're not interested, you can shut the video off now. But anyway, I promised him I would put him in the video. So
Happy New Year, everybody. This James. This is so about his... This is Reggie B. This is Ephraim. It's a walking, a broken. Next, hold on. This is Brooklyn. This is walking. Walk a bug, talk in my bunk. This is a walking. Okay, I'm a mama. Okay, I'm. Who do you not going to use? Okay, see you soon.
Check JB's vinyl and cassettes out. And as always, thanks for watching.